especially in the day that in which we live. The child of God's desire ought to be like John, who wrote the book of Revelation, "Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus." The best thing could happen for a Christian tonight would be for the Lord to come. That's the absolute best thing could happen. And other than that, there'll be trials, they'll have burdens, we'll be have fears and problems down here in this world. Hebrews 9 said, we're not going to go into the doctrinal aspect of this verse, but I want to preach it all practical tonight. "So Christ was once offered," verse 28, "to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." There is no doubt about the Bible teaches Jesus Christ is going to come back. He's coming again. There are those old musty studies and dark old corners of some colleges where professors sit and turn it up a little bit on this, please. And they try to make the second coming spiritual. And they say, well, when you get saved, that's the second coming. Or when he comes to you in salvation, that's the second coming. No. The Bible said this same Jesus, them angels did, who went up shall come in like manner. Just like he went up, he's going to come back down. That is called the blessed hope for a child of God. If you believe that, you can be a happy Christian. Now, I want to preach tonight on the subject, living in the light of the Lord's return. Living in the light of the Lord's return. Over 200 times, just in the New Testament, of 260 chapters, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ is mentioned. That means over two-thirds of the verses almost mention something about the coming of the Lord, or the chapters, almost two-thirds of the chapters. And so tonight, we'll look at how are we to live in the light of this great truth and prophecy. Several things right quick. Number one, we are to look for his coming. I'll teach you tonight, learn to look for the coming of the Lord. Learn to get in the habit of it. The Bible said in Titus chapter 2 and verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I heard about an old preacher one time that he said every morning when he woke up, he would go to the window and open up the window. And he'd look out and say, "Lord, I'm looking for you to come today. But if you do come, you're going to find me busy." And the next day he'd say, "Lord, I'm looking for you to come today. And if you come, you're going to find me busy." That's what I'm talking about. Looking for his return. The Bible said in Acts 1:11, as I said a minute ago, this same Jesus which come in as it went shall come again in like manner. There's an old preacher out in Mississippi years ago preaching on Matthew 24:27, and he's talking about the light shine from one end of heaven to the other, and he said that light is going to shine across the sky, and about that time a huge light fixture above the pulpit fell and just busted right in the floor. And those people like to have a heart attack. I mean, they jumped, and I mean, bam, that light shot across that room. And he said, just like that, that's how quick, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, you know, the Lord could come tonight. I know there's a lot of argument, them internet preachers fussing all the time. There's a lot of people deserting the doctrine of the rapture of the church and things like that because they've given up on the Lord coming. He ain't come yet, and they're scared the Lord's going to wait. And they're not looking for the Lord, they're looking for the Antichrist. He never told us to look for the Antichrist. He told us to look for the real Christ, looking for that blessed hope, looking for that blessed hope. I'm not looking for a sign. I'm listening for a sound. Amen? We are not sign seekers. We are sign readers. And brother, where the signs are there, they're getting closer and closer. I thought about all this stuff going on. This CRISPR thing that I mentioned in one of my video presentations. May do some more of it at the youth rally. Where that they are actually attempting to alter human DNA. and they're trying to mix machine and men. I don't know if y'all are aware of this or not, but they're trying to put machine computer chips inside your body, and they're even talking about putting them in your head that will react with your brain and react off of brain waves so that you can just think something and your door open or something like that. And you know what that is? That comes from the book of Daniel, where the Daniel said that image of that toes, the last kingdom, would be part iron and part clay. We are made out of clay. Human beings are just made out of clay. Iron in that Old Testament is always a picture of that devil and the Antichrist, and they're going to mix iron and clay. And buddy, we are seeing that take place. They're saying that our experts are afraid tonight because they're trying to alter human DNA, and the time's coming where you can say, I want a son. I'd like for this son to be 6'3". I'd like for him to have an IQ of 180. I'd like for him to look a certain way, have abilities in music, program into his DNA music ability, athletic ability, physical strength, and all that. You say, Brother Danny, you think God will let that? I don't know. He said there'd be a mixing iron and clay. Bible said in Genesis that the sons of God saw the daughters of men. There was a lot of mixing going on then. I don't know what all. There's no telling what they're doing right now that me and you don't even know about. I'm telling you tonight, brother, that makes me as a Christian just want to just look up and just look up, for our redemption draws nigh, glory to God. I mean, when we see the stuff going on with same-sex marriages. There's a guy out there that now he's not a man or a woman. He's not a man. He's not a woman. Let me tell you kids something. You're going to get so confused watching them stupid internet videos and what's on TV that they're going to make you think it is normal for you to think you're a girl when you're really a boy, and you think you're a boy when you're really a girl. And God made you a boy. You are a boy. And if you change yourself, you're still a boy, and you're going to answer to God as a boy trying to be a girl. I'm telling you tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we are to be looking for His coming. If I've ever seen a time in my life when I thought the Lord is coming, it's now. Thank God. Amen. Hallelujah. He's coming. We're to look for His coming. We're to look for His coming. We're to look for His coming. Old D.L. Moody said one time when he preached, he said, every time I preach, he said, the Lord may, he said, I think the Lord may come before I preach again. The Lord may come before the youth rally. The Lord may come before next Sunday morning. I'm telling you, we're to look for His coming. Well, not only that, this evening, let me say secondly tonight, we are to pray for His coming. We are to pray for His coming. The Bible said in Revelation 22:20, the last prayer of the Bible, the last prayer of the Bible, the Lord said, I come quickly. And John said, even so, Lord, come, Lord Jesus. You know what John said? Let her rip, Lord. Pull the switch. Anytime you're ready, I'm ready. If it satisfies you, it satisfies me. Now, I want to tell y'all tonight, ladies and gentlemen, there ain't nothing in this world that's any better tonight for a Christian than for the Lord to take us out of this world. I'm telling you, you wouldn't have a problem that couldn't be solved in 15 seconds if the Lord come tonight. You never have to worry about paying them old bills. You wouldn't have to worry about old Arthur getting in your ankle or Arthur getting in your shoulder. You wouldn't have to worry about Bert getting burst in there neither. You wouldn't have to worry about cancer. You wouldn't have to worry about diabetes. Wouldn't never have another doctor appointment ever. Won't never have another burden, never have another trial. Won't have to worry about your kids. Won't have to worry about your grandkids. Won't have to worry about your mom and daddy. Won't have to worry about your brother. Won't have to worry about your sister. Thank God, brother, it'll all be over but to shout. After the judgment seat of Christ, we're to pray for the coming of the Lord. Now, thy kingdom come. That's what he said. Pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. The Lord taught us to pray for His coming. I heard Franklin Graham's prayer at the presidential inauguration, and it was good, but I didn't hear him pray for the Lord's kingdom to come. I wish he would have. He might have mentioned it. I don't know. I heard on radio. I was driving that day. And I don't know. I didn't hear anybody get on there saying, well, as our new president comes in, the best thing could happen for us would be for the Lord to come back. No. I mean, some old Graham ought to have gone on there and said, I'll tell you right now, Jesus come back and get us out of this old sin-cursed world and get a hold of him and her and him and her and him and her and all them, every one of them, brother. I mean, just let her rip. I'm telling you, we're supposed to pray the Lord will come back. Now, I do this on a regular basis. Do you? Does anybody else in here pray for the Lord to come? I do. How many of you have heard me pray and I'll say, Lord, come get us out of this old world and take us home to be with you? I pray that on a regular basis because I know that it ain't getting no better down here. You say, oh, you're just an old negative pessimistic, old doomsday. No, I'm not. I am what you call a realist. And realistically, this thing's shot, brother. It's getting worse and worse. The morals ain't going to get no better. There ain't going to be no worldwide revival. Everybody gets saved and everybody live happily ever after. Brother, it's going to be hell by the high faker from here on in. There's the three biggest and best wars are in the future. Revelation 4, Revelation 6, Revelation 19. There's war coming. There's famine coming. There's the worst time this world's ever seen up ahead because of the sin of this world. And by the way, God's not going to let our country, America, get by with the way we spit in his face and walked on his word and desecrated his things of God and made a mockery out of it. God's not going to take that sitting down. Ain't going to do it. Ain't going to do it. Ain't going to do it. Somebody wrote a letter the other day and said, I like to hear him preach, but why does he have to scream and holler? Because I got something to scream and holler about. Now, if I could scream louder, I would. And if it bothers you, I say, hallelujah, you need to be bothered. Somebody need to shake you real good and wake you up out of your deadness and get you right with God. Come, Lord, straighten out this mess. Get your people out of here. You know when God got his people out of Egypt's bondage? When they cried to him. Children of Israel cried and said, Lord, help them. And the Lord sent them a deliverer. You know what? We ought to pray. Come, Lord, quickly, Lord Jesus, and get us out. Number three. What a preach he's coming. What a preach he's coming. We don't set dates. No man knows the day or the hour. But we do know the times and the season. You know why I preach on the second coming? Because every great preacher in the Bible and out of the Bible, preached on the second coming. John did when he preached, even so come quickly. Paul did in 1 Thessalonians 4 when he said, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And we which are alive and remain, the dead in Christ rise first. We'll crawl up together, meet them in the clouds of the Lord. Meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. He preached it. Peter preached it. But the day of the Lord will come. And like a thief in the night. John preached it. Jude preached it. When he said, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. All the Old New Testament apostles and prophets preached that Jesus is coming back. All great preachers of the faith preached that Jesus is coming back. I am amazed. I am blown away, as they say, by the ignorance of the scripture on the second coming of people in churches tonight. I'll guarantee you, if you went to the churches in this county tonight, you could probably go in the average church and ask the first 10 people, Sunday school teachers, deacons, laymen, people been in church all their life, stand up and quote me 3 verses about the coming of the Lord. Most of them probably couldn't do it. And our generation, you ever seen that guy on TV, old Waters, old Jesse Waters, whatever, and he goes out and interviews people and he asks them, and you'd be surprised how dumb this young generation is about our country, about our history, about the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. They don't know who the presidents are. They don't know who, Lord have mercy, but they know every movie star. They know every rock singer. They know every rapper. They know every athlete. They know who plays on whose team, but are ignorant concerning the Word of God. I read something the other day, or heard something the other day, wrote these illustrations down. These are actual answers to tests that college and high school students wrote answering the test. Now listen. If they're this ignorant of regular things, think about how ignorant of the Scripture. First, they say, what is a bamboo? What is bamboo? The answer, a bamboo is an Italian baby. What? Laugh, y'all, and they won't know how dumb you are. What is a tantrum? What is a tantrum? The answer they gave, a two-seated bicycle. That's a tantrum, you know. Tantrum, like, somebody, they said, what's an oboe? One wrote, an oboe is an American tramp. An oboe is an instrument you play, y'all. They thought, hobo. What is a comma? What's a comma? It's something that real sick people fall into. What is filet mignon? They said it's an opera by Fuccini. What is Kodak? What is Kodak? The Bible of the Muslims. What is the age of Homer? That's the Koran. What is the age of Homer? One of them said, I reckon about 40. That was the age of history. Name four animals that inhabit the polar region. One kid put two seals and two polar bears. That's pretty slick. Right. Correct this sentence. They put in there, correct this sentence. The toast was drank in silence. The kid put, the toast was eaten in silence. That shows, yeah, the toast, you know, like a toast to drink. The toast was drank in silence. The toast was eaten in silence. Name the superlative. You know, if you know, you learn what a superlative is. It said, name the superlative of handsome. Handsome, hand more, hand much. Name bad. They put bad, sick, and dead. listen, that's how ignorant our generation is. And if you think that's bad, you start asking about the Bible. You want to see an ignorant? We have never had more information at our fingertips and are dumber than this generation is right now. Have you ever read some old sermons of Charles Spurgeon and some of them guys? If you got up and talked like that nowadays, half the people couldn't even understand you. Them guys spoke such good, clear, highly exalted English. I mean, but they were educated. And it seems like the further we go, the dumber people get. And I'm telling you tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we ought to know He's coming. We ought to know how He's coming. We ought to know who He's coming for. And we ought to know that we're ready to meet Him at His coming. Number four, we are to love His coming. We are to love His coming. Amen? The Bible said that we are to love His appearing. Would you love to see Him tonight? You get a crown of righteousness if you do. Not unto them only, but to them that love His appearing. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, and not to me only, but unto all them that love His appearing. I can guarantee you one crown you'll get in heaven. All you got to do is love to see Him come back. If you'd love to see Him come back, you get that crown right there. Paul said, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, and not for me only, but unto all them that love His appearing. I'm telling you, before this thing's over, I have an idea. We're going to be want to love to see Him appear and come back. We are to love His appearing. We are to comfort one another with these words. I've told a lot of people that the best thing could happen would be for the Lord to come back. Now, if you've heard the story of the girl who maybe her fiancé's gone off to army, and they had to put him off in another country somewhere. He's in Iraq or he's in Iran or something like that. And he says, I'm coming back, honey, I'm coming back. And then she gets her a boyfriend on the side, and she's cheating on him, and she gets his letters, I'm coming back. She just throws them in the trash can. He writes her a letter, I love you and I'm coming back. She just throws them in the trash can. She ain't looking for him to come. She don't want him to come. She wouldn't care if he never come. You know why? She done found her some other love. And it's sad to say a lot of Christians are like that tonight. They're out looking for the Lord to come. You're having too much fun down here in this world, hooked up with the things of the world. You say, I even know Christians that say, my goodness, we can't watch movies up there. Some of y'all going to have to do some major adjustment. We can't listen to about music, no country, no rock and roll. Nope. Sorry. You're going to have to go somewhere else to hear that stuff. That's on here. Ain't nothing hell. Ain't nothing heaven. I'm telling you, we ought to love his coming and hope he comes back. Number five. We ought to be comforted by his coming. The Bible said, wherefore comfort one another with these words. One day, the graves will be open. I preached a lot of funerals. And they have the casket out here like this, and the person's body's in that casket, and they're getting ready to lower it in the grave. And the family's sitting there in them chairs, and they're wiping tears, and they're holding mama, and people sometimes, and that wind's blowing, and it's cold. Some of the saddest funerals I've ever been in was when it was real cold. I remember one time I had one up there in Marion, and it was an older man, and he died. He'd been sick for a long time. He died, and we had his funeral, and it was snowing. I couldn't believe they had it. It was snowing flakes that big. I remember looking out the window of that funeral home thinking, we ain't going to get out of here. Flakes that big. It was snowing. It was cold. They put that body in that casket. We took off down there to the old Nebo Cemetery. And I remember going around that road. And I mean, the cars was getting stuck. They couldn't get the hearse up in there to the grave site. Had men out pushing and getting snow all over us. And I went down there and drove. And one of the saddest sights in this world is to see a family sitting there under a tent, bawling up with their loved one, been in that old cold ground like that, and that snow. It's pitiful. It'll break your heart. I wasn't even related to them, and it hurt me. It hurt. I've looked at people, and I just hurt for them. When you see the pain on their face and the pain, I mean, it breaks your heart for them. And I looked at them, and you know what I've done? I've took that Bible, and I've held it over that grave, and I said, according to this right here, that grave will open up one of these days, and that body will come out of there. It ain't going to look like it does now. He'll come with his soul. The body will come up out of the grave. They'll meet the Lord in the air and get a brand new body and never hurt again. I'm glad, glory to God, brother, the coming of the Lord brings comfort. We ought to be comforted by his coming, people. He's coming. All this old sickness and all this old stuff we're going through now, hallelujah, it'll all be over with, glory to God. I heard about a girl, I don't know if it was an accident or an argument they got into, but her husband shot her, and the bullet went through part of her head and come out the back, and she lived. And that girl lived, but she looked awful. You couldn't stand to look at her. She had a big old sunken hole right here in her head, and her face was disfigured, and she was not ever, ever normal again. She wasn't able to take care of herself. She had messed up for life. They had her in church one night. She's sitting right up near the front. They said the evangelist was up, and he's talking about the Lord coming. And they said when the Lord comes, he'll make you whole, and everything will be all right. And that girl spoke up. And had that hole in her head, not able to even probably control herself as a normal person would. And she spoke up and said, "Preacher, when he comes, will I be made whole?" And that preacher looked down at her, and he said, "Yes, ma'am. When he comes, you're going to get a new body. You'll not have a hole in your head. You'll not have a problem with your speech. You won't have any kind of physical limitation whatsoever. It will all be fixed. You're going to have a body like unto his glorious body." The Bible puts it like this. We know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is, comforted by his coming. Number six, in closing, we're to be purified by his coming. Purified by his coming. I want to show you this one. 1 John chapter 3. Take your Bible, please. Turn to 1 John chapter 3. I want to read you this verse. Nothing will help and encourage you to live right any more than expecting the Lord to come back. Kids, when you're at school, remember, He could come back. Mom, when you're at work, remember, He could come back. Now, there are those, I'll get criticized for this, on the internet, they'll write us notes and letters, and they'll say, oh, that's the only, you're trying to scare people into living right, tell them the Lord could come at any minute. Well, let's see how ignorant you are of the Scripture. Let me show you 1 John chapter 3. Look at verse 1. Don't show your ignorance talking like that. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. Verse 1. That we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew Him not. Look at it. Beloved, now, right now in this world, are we the sons of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him. For we shall see Him as He is. Now watch it. Verse 3. Watch it. Listen. Everybody listen. Verse 3. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. You know what that verse said? That verse said, knowing that He's going to appear, knowing that He's coming, we ought to purify ourselves. Deal with that in plain old hillbilly language. The Lord could come any minute, so we ought to be living right. That's what that means. So you're just using that to scare people. It's a motivator. Amen? It motivates me when I'm riding down the road and the devil says, look at there. Now, you know what? The Lord could come today. See, every man that hath that hope in himself, purify himself. Somebody trying to get you to go to a dance? Somebody trying to get you to go to a club? You want me to tell you how not to do that? Realize any day Jesus could come out of that sky. Every man that hath this hope in himself purifies himself. That's what the Bible says. It'll make you live right. It'll make you turn your TV off. It'll make you turn the wine glass down. It'll make you say no to the whoremonger at work, to the flirty little girl over there for you mad men. It'll make you say no to the drugs, no to the pot, no to the pills. He could come any day. Purify yourself. Purify yourself. Don't do nothing that you wouldn't do if you thought Jesus would come today. Don't go nowhere that you wouldn't go if you thought Jesus could come today. Somebody said like this, listen, young people, it's so very hard when your friends are doing wrong to stand for what's right and not just go along. For sure, some will laugh and others will poke fun. But the ones that really count respect you when it's done. Remember, men of greatness have always stood alone. They started at it early, not till after they're grown. So when you face the Lord and you've done what's right, He'll say you've done well, for you did His delight. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in His law doth He meditate day and night. You've heard me tell this story over and over and over. A little girl at school one day, the principal came in. He said, now, boys and girls, I'm going out to do some work. And I'm going to come back in here sometime today. And when I come back, whoever's got the cleanest, neatest desk is going to get a nice prize. And he named off some real nice prize. And they all said, oh, I want that, I want that, I want that, I want that. And he said, I'll be back. And so he left. And one little girl in that class, she had the messiest desk in the whole school. And everybody knew it. I mean, there was trash, pencils in the floor, her pocketbook hanging off the edge of the seat, you know, chewing gum wrappers, you know, and her writing all over and everything. Buddy, she went to work, and she straightened up that desk, and she threw all her trash in the trash can. She put her pencils up here at the top of the desk. She straightened up her books. She sat there, and she said, I'm going to win that prize. I've got the neatest desk in the class. And one of them turned around and said, yeah, well, what if he don't come in the morning? What if he comes in the evening? She'll say, every evening? I'm going to straighten up my desk I'm going to put my pencils up here, trash in trash can, books all in place. I'll have everything neat, and I'll be ready. If he comes in the evening. And they said, but what if he don't come in the evening? What if he comes about lunchtime? She went, Every day at lunch, I'm going to take my pencils and erasers, and I'm going to straighten up my desk, put my trash in trash cans, hang my pocketbook over here, and I'll be ready if he comes at noontime. And they said, well, if he comes about 1:30 or 2 o'clock? And she said, I'll just keep it clean. And she hit the nail on the head right there. I'll just keep it clean. You want to be ready to meet the Lord? Let me give some advice. Keep it clean. If you mess up, get down and say, God, forgive me. Wash all my sins away. Keep your heart. If you mess up again, hit your knees again and keep asking God to forgive you. Keep it clean. Amen. You know, there's a lot of people be in pretty good shape if the Lord come on Sunday afternoon about 1 o'clock. But boy, if he come Friday night, would they be in trouble. If the Lord come last Friday night, where we found you? I was at home studying. That's where I was at last night. I wanted to watch the Carolina Tar Heels and Duke play so bad I couldn't stand it. And I said, I gotta preach tomorrow. And I wouldn't let myself watch it. And so they was watching it downstairs. And I went down there and said, halftime, who's ahead? And Ethan kept me up speed, and I watched like the last minute. But you know what? I thought, you know what's more important than a ball game? It's me being ready to preach tomorrow morning. And me standing up in front of them little boys and little girls. And tell them there's a God and there's eternity and we're going to die. And that's more important. You know what I found out? You know how to be ready to meet the Lord? Keep it clean, y'all. Amen. Keep it clean. Let's stand by our heads for prayer. Let's stand by.